Hello everyone, I'm here to present on facial nerve palsy. So this is an overview of the anatomy of facial nerve. I know it looks a bit complicated, but we'll go through this slowly. So anatomy, the course of the facial nerve can be divided into two parts. There's an intracranial portion and there's an extracranial portion. So basically the intracranial portion, the name says, basically of course it's the course of the nerve through the cranial cavity and the cranium itself. Extracranial is the course of the nerve outside the cranium through the face and the neck. So it starts intracranial, the nerve arrives from the pons. It begins as two roots. There's a large motor root and a small sensory root. The part of the facial nerve that arises from the sensory root is sometimes known as the intermediate nerve. The two roots travel through the internal acoustic meatus, a 1 cm long opening in the petrous part of the temporal bone. Here, they are in very close proximity to the inner ear. Still within the temporal bone, the roots leave the internal acoustic meatus and enter into the facial canal. Within the facial canal, three important events occur. Firstly, the two roots fuse to form the facial nerve. Secondly, the nerve forms the geniculate ganglion. And lastly, the nerve gives rise to the greater petrosal nerve, which gives parasympathetic fibers to the glands, the nerve to the stapedius, and the chorda tympani, which is special sensory fibers to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. The facial nerve then exits the facial canal and the cranium via the stylomastoid foramen. This is an exit located just posterior to the styloid process of the temporal bone. Here is the extracranial portion, and after exiting the skull, the facial nerve turns superiorly to run just anterior to the outer ear. The first branch to arise is the posterior auricular nerve. It provides motor innervation to some of the muscles around the ear. Immediately distal to this, motor branches are sent to the posterior belly of the digastric muscle and to the stylohyoid muscle. The main trunk of the nerve, now termed the motor root of the facial nerve, now continues anteriorly and inferiorly into the parotid gland. But please note that the facial nerve does not contribute toward innervation of the parotid gland. Within the parotid gland, the nerve terminates by splitting to five branches: the temporal, the zygomatic, the buccal, the marginal mandibular branch, and the cervical branch. And these are important for innervating the muscles of the facial expression. The temporal branch innervates the frontalis, orbicularis, and the corrugators. The zygomatic branch innervates the orbicularis. The buccal innervates the orbicularis, oris, fascinator, and zygomaticus muscle. The marginal mandibular branch innervates the mentalis muscle, and cervical branch innervates the platysma, and all these control the facial expression. So this is another picture showing you the overview of the distribution of facial nerve. In particular, the zoster affects the facial nerve, which what we call Ramsay Hunt syndrome, can result in zoster eruptions in the ear as well as in the mouth as well. So what's the clinical relevance? So this is the longest intraosseous course of any cranial nerve, which is 3 cm. The portion of the nucleus that supplies the muscles of the upper part of the face receives cortical nuclear fibers from both sides of the brain, and the lower half of the face receives fibers from only contralateral cortex. Hence, an upper motor neuron lesion affects only the contralateral lower part of the face, and this is called central palsy. Usually, the forehead is spared. The other relevance is lesions above the geniculate ganglion causes more severe eye symptoms because it affects tear production as well as orbicularis closure of the eye. The chordae tympani also reduce salivation and loss of taste on the ipsilateral two-thirds of the tongue. The nerve to the stapedius results in ipsilateral hyperacusis, which means they are very hypersensitive to sound. The greater petrosal nerve reduces ipsilateral tear production. Extracranial lesions occur during the extracranial course of the facial nerve, which is distal to the styloid-mastoid foramen. Only the motor function of the facial nerve is affected, resulting in paralysis or severe weakness of muscles of the facial expression. So what's aberrant regeneration? There's two main aberrant regeneration you need to know. First is the crocodile tears. Basically, when they eat, the patient would tear a lot, and this is the result of the parasympathetic fibers, which normally innervate the salivary gland, are misdirected to the lacrimal gland. So, there is excessive tear secretion when the patient eats. Aberrant facial regeneration, resulting in slaying kinesis, can also result in abnormal facial movement. So this is the aberrant connection of the motor fibers originally innervating the orbicularis oris to the orbicularis oculi, causing lid closure whenever the patient smiles, talks, or eats. If this is severe, this can lead to social embarrassment and functional visual loss. The epidemiology. The incidence is estimated 17 to 35 per 100,000. It's also reported in neonates to be 0.8 to 1.8 per 1,000. And 91% of these occur due to forceps injury. And most commonly, the most common etiology is Bell's, which is almost half. Others are traumatic, 22%. And 7% is caused by Ramsay Hunt. And just some trivia, Sylvester Stallone was born with facial nerve palsy. So sometimes when you listen to the way he speaks, he sounds like he's mumbling or he's got slurred speech. So causes. This table shows the common causes of seven nerve palsy. The most common cause is idiopathic or Bell's. Other can be infection, such as Ramsay Hunt, trauma, like fractures of the temporal bone, such as an RTA, or iatrogenic after CP angle tumor surgery, or neoplastic, or acoustic neuroma, or even the parotid gland itself compresses on the facial nerve. So depending where the location of the lesion, if it's a supranuclear lesion, then the cause is usually from a stroke, tumor, or multiple sclerosis. If it's an infranuclear lesion, the lesion can be in nuclear 7th, CP angle, facial canal, or parotid. In the nuclear, affecting the pons, you may get Millard-Gubler syndrome, which is associated with 6th nerve, and contralateral limb weakness from affected pyramidal tract. If signs of 8th nerve involvement such as deafness, tinnitus, vertigo, hyperacusis, think of CP angle tumor or pathology. Other locations will be facial canal in the parotids, and the facial muscles will be affected. Bell's palsy is a unilateral condition, is idiopathic and sudden onset. There's 60% of patients report preceding viral illnesses, and it is spontaneous complete recovery of Bell's palsy occurs in up to 70% of cases. Usually remission begins within the first 3 to 4 weeks with complete recovery within the first 6 months. And it is idiopathic, but some mechanisms proposed include viral, such as HSV activation, inflammatory, or even compressive, as we see Bell's in pregnancy from edema and compression. Other symptoms the patient may complain of besides just the facial paralysis can be earache, facial numbness, tongue numbness, ear numbness, even hyperacusis, tinnitus, taste disturbances, and decreased hearing. Treatment is quite controversial, as many papers show that steroid acyclovir might work, but there are other papers which show that there's no proven benefit. Let's go to Ramsay Hunt syndrome, which is herpes zoster affecting the geniculate ganglion. So they have a triad of ophthalgia, vesicles in external ear canal, and ipsilateral facial nerve palsy, and may be associated with vestibule auditory symptoms and is very near the 8th nerve. Other infections affecting 7th nerve reported includes Lyme, HIV, TB, leprosy, cat scratch, polio, and dengue. And Ramsay Hunt has a much less favorable recovery profile than Bell's palsy, as only 21% return to normal function and 79% of patients develop sequelae, and more than half have very poor recovery. Neoplastic cause of 7th nerve palsy, the tumor affects 7th nerve by either direct compression, stretching, or even direct infiltration of the nerve. So other causes can be CP angle tumor surgery itself, can lead to iatrogenic cause of contiguous 5th, 6th, 8th and Horner syndrome with decreased hearing and hyperacusis. Commonly in our population, if the NPC affected spinopalatine ganglion or cavernous sinus results in isolated tear deficiency and facial nerve palsy. So this is the grading used for facial nerve palsy that ENT sometimes uses, the Hals-Breckmann grading. So it is graded from 1 to 6. As you can see, 1 is normal, 6 is total paralysis. Some studies have also used it for prognostication for chances of recovery. So what's the clinical approach? First of all patients, we must take a proper history, medical history, any ischemic risk factors, stroke, what's the progression of the symptoms, any diplopia and any giddiness. And for clinical exam, we need to check the vision, the pupils, check the cornea, we need to check the schmerz, because if it is affected, it implies a pathology is upstream from the origin of the greater superficial petrosal nerve or above its path. And external exam, we need to look at whether there's any brow ptosis, associated paralytic ectropion, leg ophthalmos, and Bell's phenomenon. We also ask the patient to raise the eyebrows. If there's sparing of forehead, alarm bells must ring because it may mean a central cause. We must also refer to the ENT or do a simple ENT exam, including looking for parotid swelling, any ear vesicles, and check for mastoid tenderness. Oral examination is very uncommonly done, but you can try to check the taste of the anterior two-third of the tongue. And of course, a full neuro examination is indicated. So we recommend imaging if it is a central facial palsy, which means the sparing of the forehead, there's recurrent seven nerve palsy, there's multiple cranial nerve, contiguous cranial nerve involvement, and if there's partial seven nerve palsy, which means isolated of the branches are paralyzed instead of the whole face. If Bell palsy is not resolved by 3 months, we will recommend to do a scanning. Imaging should include both the internal auditory canal and face to image the whole course of the facial nerve. If an MRI is contraindicated, a contrast-enhanced CT can be used. For blood investigation, only if it's an endemic area of Lyme, then we'll order Lyme serology. And the endemic areas can be found on the CDC website. For example, in USA, certain states such as New York, Pennsylvania actually have Lyme endemic. The facial EMG is usually not done. If complete paralysis, there's a small chance they would have poor prognosis, and some of the patients, sometimes the facial EMG may help to prognosticate or even plan for reconstruction surgery. But if it's a partial paralysis, the chance of recovery is excellent in Bell's palsy, and EMG testing provides no clinical benefit. Medical treatment. So systemic steroid should be offered if patient presents within the first 3 days of onset of Bell's palsy to increase the chance of recovery for patients above 16 years old. Patients are started on either prednisolone 50 mg for 10 days or 60 mg for 5 days with a 5-day taper with a total of 10-day dose. Oral acyclovir may be offered in combination with steroids, but it's not been proven to be of benefit in treatment of Bell's palsy in some large clinical trial, although a small benefit cannot be completely excluded. Because of the potential small benefit of facial nerve recovery and quite low risk of antiviral therapy, the clinician may consider starting this in combination. However, it is not recommended to start antiviral therapy alone. For us, the ophthalmic management, when you see patients in ECS, these are the things we need to give. First of all, it's targeted at preventing exposure keratopathy. So we need to give lubricants, taping, moist chambers, punctal plugs to improve the dry eyes. Other temporizing methods include Botox to induce ptosis or even tarsal. Permanent treatment is only done if likely there's no chance of recovery for the patient. And basically, we can narrow the palpable aperture in 4 ways, either lowering the upper lid, raising the lower lid, close the middle side of the eye, or close the lateral side of the eye. For upper lid, to lower it, we can consider gold weight insertion. The other thing is palpable spring, which we seldom use. It's actually a custom-made stainless steel spring implanted and secured to the superior orbital rim and pre-tarsal area. When the levator relaxes, as the opposite eye closes, the spring actively pushes the eyelid down. The spring allows for more rapid eyelid excursion and complete closure compared to gold weights and help to restore the corneal squeegee effect. However, erosion is a common problem that may need frequent adjustments, so we don't do it very commonly here. It is also very common to have a lid retraction in seven nerve palsy, and this is actually caused by the Herring's law of unposed levator action, and is also due to the stiffness of the levator. If retraction is present, we need to consider doing a mullerectomy or even a levator recession. So this is a photo of trial of goal weights. The goal weights come in 0.6 gram in 0.2 increments. So ideal weight would be one of that achieves adequate reduction of leg ophthalmos without inducing significant ptosis. And this is the picture below showing another patient who had the goal lid already implanted in the lids. So to raise the upper lid, we can perform surgeries to address the leg's lower lid and the ectropion. Methods such as medial and lateral cantoplasty, spacer, autologous facial sling can be used. Lateral and medial palpable aperture can be narrowed. Tarsal is not commonly done due to the poor cosmetic results, and there are better methods of addressing the Bell's palsy, which is mentioned before. Other methods can include lateral canthal sling, medial cantoplasty, medial tarsal strip, and the medial wedge excision. The prognosis in Bell's palsy is good. As mentioned, 70% of them resolve, and remission usually starts from week 3 to week 4. Recurrence rate is reported to be 12%. However, Ramsay Hunt syndrome has a much poorer prognosis, as 79% of patients develop sequelae and more than half have poor recovery. So what do you do when you see a patient referred to you for seven nerve palsy in the clinic, the ECS, or the A&E? So when you see a patient like this, the approach should take a proper history, full examination, to rule out other cranial nerve involvement and whether it is a central cause. If it is a central cause, we need to have urgent neuroimaging and refer to the relevant subspec. Bell's is actually an diagnosis of exclusion, and there's both ophthalmic and systemic management. Systemic management would include to start a course of steroid with or without antiviral, and we can consider referring to the ENT or A&E if the patient presents within the first 3 days of onset. If the patient told you that they have already had this problem for about 2 weeks, there's not real proven benefit in starting so late. But of course, you can discuss with your physician colleagues. Please ensure all patients have an ENT appointment for a scope and a follow-up. And patient usually needs neuroimaging with no resolution by 3 months. The ophthalmic management is targeted mainly to protect the cornea. So in ECS, you can manage a patient just has mild keratopathy. However, this patient may need further referral to ocular or corneal service if there's severe involvement or poor chance of recovery. The frequency and the TCU depends on the severity of eye involvement. So just to summarize again, for all patients with facial nerve, please take a full proper history, a full eye and neuro exam to localize the site of lesion. For Bell's palsy, is the most common cause of facial nerve palsy. But remember, it's a diagnosis of exclusion, so please exclude all other pathology before you label it Bell's. All these may need co-management with the ENT or the neurologist, and the main aim of eye treatment is actually just to protect the cornea. Treatment depends on prognosis and reversibility of facial nerve palsy. Thank you.